Now we would listen to Dr. Jesal Sheth. She's a consultant pediatric intensivist and neonatologist at Fortis Hospital Limited, Mulund, Mumbai.
Organizing team to give me an opportunity to actually start this session today. I'm trying to talk about interventions to improve preterm outcomes, and this is a very, very important topic for us as a neonatologist because the premature babies are a sort of, you know, even in the neonatology, there are the different subsets of the babies who require more special attention, care, precautions, understanding, and the burden is huge. Every year, almost 15 million babies are born prematurely in the world, and the number is still rising. It is a leading cause of death for the children under the 5. 3/4 of these deaths can be prevented by current cost-effective interventions. And across 184 countries, the rate is somewhere ranging between 5 to 8%. So, WHO defines preterm as a babies who are born before completed 37 weeks of the gestational age. They are subdivided into 3 categories: extremely preterm, very preterm, and moderate to late preterm, depending on the gestational age. Now, I think we nowadays are top in many areas, and this is one of the areas where we still are at top. I'm not really very happy about it. The top 10 countries in the world which has the greatest number of the preterm births, the India is number 1. 35 million babies are born prematurely every year in India, and this number is really huge. I mean, in a way, that's how we serve as a neonatologist, but this is not the number we should be very proud about. So, in 2015 and 16, WHO jointly with the UNICEF, FIGO, and PMNCH came up with the joint statement on interventions to improve preterm birth outcomes. And these guidelines are so well defined that I thought of, you know, actually going through this guideline and try to, you know, correct our understanding, and then try to look into, you know, where we stand as of today. The word of caution, before we follow WHO recommendation, one must ensure that, you know, local protocols have been respected. People should pay careful attention during antenatal care visits, because the outcomes are affected by antenatal visits itself. Healthcare staff should be well trained when we are taking it into the interiors of the country. There should be enough local arrangements to ensure ample samples and supplies of antenatal steroids, mixtures, and antibiotics, because that's what the guideline states. There should be good quality availability of maternal and newborn care in healthcare facility level, and one should be able to refer the mothers, preferably antenatally, if there is imminent preterm birth, in case if the facilities are not available. So these are the simple guidelines. The summary of the guidelines to improve preterm outcomes for the mothers are: the WHO recommends use of antenatal corticosteroids, antibiotics for preterm pre-labor rupture of the membranes, and use of the magnesium sulfate for the delivery happening at less than 32 weeks of the gestational age if preterm birth is likely within 24 hours for the neuroprotection. WHO discourages the practices like use of tocolysis to prolong the delivery, use of antibiotics for the preterm labor with intact membranes, and antenatal corticosteroid usage in confirmed chorioamnionitis, who is likely to develop prematurely. Recommendations for the babies are thermal protection, monitoring of the oxygen levels and cardiorespiratory status, use of CPAP for preterm with RDS, use of surfactant for RDS, and restricted use of the O2 therapy in terms of 30% oxygen or room air to start with the resuscitation in babies born prematurely less than 32 weeks of the gestational age, and then to titrate as per the defined criteria. WHO discourages the practices like prophylactic surfactant usage before the diagnosis of the RDS, and not to use 100% oxygen at the time of the preterm delivery. So just let's look at the guidelines actually in little more detail and see, you know, what exactly and what are basically the nitty-gritty of these guidelines. So One thing I must tell you, all these guidelines have been based on basically all the complaint reviews which have been published in last 10 to 15 years. So actually there is not much to discuss or debate, and I think we just need to understand why these guidelines are made in the first place, so that, you know, acceptance becomes much more easier. So this was the concurrent database system review published in 2017, which states that continued use of the single dose antenatal steroid to accelerate fetal lung maturation in women at risk of preterm birth is very much favorable. So another publication in 2017 in BMJ, where infants were exposed to antenatal corticosteroids and they had a significant lower rate of the death before the discharge at each gestational age, like at 29 weeks or even lesser, at 31 weeks and at 33 to 34 weeks, compared to infants who did not get exposed to antenatal steroids. And the rate of survival without major hospital morbidity was higher among infants exposed to antenatal corticosteroids at the lowest gestational age. Whether to use prenatal corticosteroids in a repeated doses or not. So what the current Cochrane systemic review states is, if one uses the repeated doses of the corticosteroids, there are no serious harms to mother in terms of increased risk of the infection to the mother versus the baby, or any immediate neonatal adverse outcomes. And that's why there is no harm in using the repeat dose of the corticosteroid in antenatal stage if the gestational age of the mother at the time of the delivery is less than 34 weeks. So what the WHO recommends, the antenatal corticosteroid therapy is recommended for women at risk of preterm delivery between 24 to 34 weeks of gestational age if the following criteria are met. If the gestational age assessment is done accurately, preterm birth is considered imminent or within 7 days, if there is no clinical evidence of active maternal infection in terms of chorioamnionitis, and if the adulted child birth care is available and newborn care is available. For the eligible woman, it should be administered within 7 days. It should be administered if the delivery is being considered imminent within 7 days of starting the treatment, including first 24 hours. It should be given in the multiple gestations versus the single versus the multitones in mothers having PIH, as far as mother's blood pressure is under the control, in mothers with the diabetes mellitus, even in the mothers with the premature rupture of the membranes without the evidence of chorioamnionitis, and also in the IGR babies. It is not recommended in women undergoing planned LSCS at the gestational age between 34 to 36 weeks. So if between 34 to 36 weeks, if the delivery is happening in emergency, if mother is going into the preterm labor, one can still use it up to 36 weeks of the gestation, 36 plus 6 by 7, up to those many days you can use antenatal steroids. But if it is a planned elective LSCS for any indication, then it is not encouraged. And a single repeat course of the antenatal corticosteroid is recommended if preterm birth does not occur within 7 days after the initial dose, but there is no benefit of giving more than 2 courses. So after that, if you are lucky and baby is in utero, one does not need to repeat more than 2 courses of the antenatal corticosteroid because there is no added benefit. So if there is a fashion of giving weekly steroids, just because, you know, mommy is in the kind of bed rest, short circle length or any other reason, one should not be giving more than 2 doses. There is no added benefit. Tocolytic treatment is not recommended for anyone at risk of imminent preterm birth for the purpose of improving newborn outcomes. Now the role of the magnesium sulfate. Again, there is a lot of evidence, and now the concurrent systemic reviews published in actually 2009 and 10. That's why this is a part of the guidelines in American Society of Obstetrics and Gynecologists, as well as WHO has recommended that use of the mixed cell for the mother. There are 3 indications. So one is, you know, as a tocolytic for the short term use if mother is a PIH, is a purely maternal indication. But from the preterm indication, it should be used for the fetal neuroprotection for the possible benefit of reducing the risk of developing cerebral palsy if the delivery is happening at the gestational age less than 32 weeks. Now, antibiotics, so routine antibiotic administration is not recommended to a mother in a preterm labor with the intake amniotic membranes and no clinical sign of the infection. But other way around, antibiotic administration is strongly recommended for women with the preterm pre-labor rupture of the membranes. And they have advocated basically the use of the macrolide, which is basically erythromycin, that has been well studied. I'm not sure what, I mean, we use all the cephalosporin in our year. No, you will still give macrolides, very good. So, WHO also states that the routine delivery by LSCS is not recommended just because the delivery is happening prematurely. It does not affect the outcomes of the preterm baby. So, it doesn't matter whether baby is syphilic or breech, as far as the obstetrician is confident, normal delivery is. Normal delivery is no contraindication or not to be discouraged. Now, to improve preterm outcomes of the thermal care, the kangaroo care has been strongly encouraged by the WHO. Currently, WHO is conducting actually a very mega study. 50 minutes hour? Wow. So what they say, if the baby is born less than 2 kilo premature, less than 36 weeks, then kangaroo care should be initiated as soon as possible if the babies are clinically stable. And they actually are now, they are nowadays they are studying continuous kangaroo care, and then secondly, if there is any clinical indication where you have to separate the mother and baby for baby being clinically unstable, then also one should do intermittent kangaroo care a few times a day in first few days right from the healthcare facilities is very much encouraged. If babies are clinically unstable, then they encourage use of radio formal versus the incubator based on the availability. And plastic, use of the plastic of the plastic bags are not routinely recommended, but it can be used for the transport inter or intra facility in case to minimize the heat loss if you don't have transport incubator. Now, delayed versus early umbilical cord clamping for preterm infants, I think it has again been a very well studied. Delayed cord clamping at least more than 60 seconds is highly recommended. It has shown to improve the higher hemoglobin levels, it improves iron storages, it improves infants and children's neurodevelopmental outcome. It leads to lesser degree of anemia in infants at 4 months of age, higher blood pressures and lesser blood transfusions, and it decreases the rates of intraventricular hemorrhage, chronic lung disease, necrotizing enterocolitis, and late onset sepsis in babies who are born prematurely. So again, there is a bit of the controversy, how much delay is the good. So at least 60 seconds, 60 to 120 seconds, more than 120 seconds, it has not shown any favorable outcomes. So far, the current recommendation is to delay the cold clamping for at least 60 to 120 seconds. Another thing I think Dr. Iyer is going to cover in detail, I'm just going to mention what is the WHO recommendation for the babies who are born prematurely. So initially, WHO encourages supporting the transition, then actually resuscitation in the delivery room, and stimulation of the preterm baby during the stabilization also has shown to improve regular respiration. Another thing is baby should be started right at the on the CPAP rather than getting intubated in the delivery room to reduce the risk of the bronchopulmonary dysplasia, unless baby shows a degree of severe degree of the bradycardia or apnea, which is the only indication to intubate the babies in the delivery room. Using higher pressures up to 20 to 25 seconds for 10 to 30 seconds as a sustained inflation pressure to avoid the intubation in the premature baby is not routinely recommended. It has not shown any benefit. TPS device is better than the self-inflating anesthetic bag to deliver CPAP with either a face mask or nasal probe. Use of the positive pressure ventilation should be discouraged in the babies unless the babies are apneic and bradycardic. And high-frequency nasal cannula as a primary mode of the support right from the delivery room has shown to be inferior to CPAP in terms of number of the failures requiring intubation in literature. And actually, this has been published as a standard European consensus guidelines in 2019. The Europe prefers to give animal derived surfactant preparation, but WHO says give whatever is available. Early rescue surfactant should be initiated instead of giving prophylaxis, and suggested protocol to protocol for babies who should be treated with the surfactant would be if the worsening FI to more than 30% or the CPAP pressures more than 6 cm of water. These are the indications where one can try giving ensure to help the babies as a rescue surfactant administration. About the oxygen therapy, So the babies who are born at the gestational age within 32 weeks, the WHO recommends to start the oxygen therapy with 30% oxygen or air and then tailor as per the vitals of the baby. The use of progressive higher concentration of oxygen should be considered only if the babies are developing bradycardia or not bradycardia after adequate ventilation at 30% FiO2. I think giving 30% FiO2 for India is a bit of a challenge to have a, you know, venture in the delivery room. So that is kind of the area to debate, and I'd like to take the opinion from everyone. Another thing is that target saturations for the preterm should be aimed between 91% to 95%. Now it is the studies have clearly shown that targeting too lower saturation reduces the risk of ROP, but otherwise it increases the risk of mortality and NSE. And again, the heated humidified gases are should be used to stabilize the preterm baby, which can reduce the further evaporative losses. So these are basically the current WHO guidelines, and when I was trying to look at making the PPT interesting and create some controversy, I thought the guidelines are so clear and so solid with lot of clear evidence, systemic reviews around it. I didn't have much to actually mention more than what the WHO guidelines says. Thank you very much. I am sure you don't have any questions. Thank you.